Members of the Board of Trustees, Committee on Fiscal Affairs, please respond present when you hear your name. Chairperson Ferrer.
Here.
Vice Chairperson Mojica is absent and excused. Trustee Sunshine.
Present.
Trustee Berger.
Present.
Trustee Cortez Vasquez. We'll hear from her. Professor Verzani.
Present.
Great. Professor Benton.
Present.
Terrific. Timothy Hunter, the student rep. I don't see Timothy. Okay. Jonathan Hannon, the student alternate. Okay, Jonathan. And we have a quorum. This public meeting of the Committee on Fiscal Affairs is now called to order. Pursuant to the New York State Legislature's recent extension of the suspension of required in-person meetings under the open meetings law, this meeting is being held remotely via video conference with access to the public session available on the CUNY Board of Trustees website. A copy of the calendar agenda of items is also available online at the CUNY Board of Trustees website. Additional items may be added during the meeting. And as a reminder, please mute so we can ensure that everyone can hear. I'll now take a roll call attendance for members of the Chancellery and other invited guests. Members of the Chancellery and other invited guests, please respond present when you hear your name. Chancellor Matos Rodriguez.
Present.
General Counsel and Senior Vice Chancellor for Legal Affairs, Derek Davis.
Present.
Executive Vice Chancellor and Chief Operating Officer, Hector Batista.
Present.
Presenting. Interim Vice Chancellor and Chief Financial Officer, Christina Chiappa.
Present.
President Carol Mason, the COPS liaison.
Present. Present.
Hi. Catherine Abada, the University Executive Budget Director.
Present.
Howard Apson, the University Director of Environmental Health, Safety, and Risk Management.
Present.
Fareed Nassar Hyatt, the academic dean.
Present.
Mike DeYunko, Vice Chancellor for Communications and Marketing. Do we have Maite yet? Okay, not yet. Martin Sterla, the Chief Procurement Officer.
Present.
Terrific. Monica Tavares, Associate Vice Chancellor for Communications and Marketing.
Present.
Maite is there, just for the record.
She's okay, mm-hmm. Terrific. And I see we've been joined by the Chair of the Board, Bill Thompson. I will mark you present. Okay, it's all you, Freddie.
Thanks, Gail. Now let's turn to the item requiring a vote today. Given that all board members are participating remotely via Zoom and we're unable to see everyone at once, I'll announce the resolutions and ask for members to respond only if you'd like to abstain or oppose them. Otherwise, your vote will be recorded as a yes vote. If you're voting no or abstaining, please state your name and vote. Additionally, if you wish to second an item or have any questions, please state your name first for the record, and let's try to avoid speaking over one another. For our action items, action item 1A is the approval of the minutes of the March 1, 2022 meeting, and I'll move the minutes. Do I have a second?
Berger, second.
Are there any changes, discussion, comment on the minutes? We'll now vote. And please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. The minutes are unanimously approved. Now I'd like to address section 2, the policy calendar. Policy item 2A1 is a resolution to authorize the procurement of the bar exam preparation courses and a waiver of tuition and fees to third year law students attending the courses. CUNY School of Law is seeking to procure a bar exam prep course and to waive tuition and fees for the third year law school students attending the courses, following the example of other law schools, such as Howard University School of Law, University of Missouri, Kansas City School, which provide free bar exam preparation programs for all. The no-cost bar exam prep program will be a benefit to students and likely to improve their bar exam passage rates, influence standing in the national law school rankings, and have a positive influence on enrollment and tuition revenues. universities requesting the Board of Trustees to authorize a procurement of bar exam prep courses in the amount not to exceed $225,000 and a waiver of tuition and fees. CUNY School of Law Academic Dean Fareed Nasir Hayat is available to provide further background on this item if required. I'll move the item and have a second.
Berger, second.
Is there any discussion on the item? We'll now vote. Please only respond again if you'd like to abstain or oppose.
There are a couple of hands up, sorry.
Professor yes. Verzani and
I'm Jonathan sorry, Hayden. I didn't see that. Professor Verzani first.
I'll let the student go first in case he's replicating what I have to say.
Would you like to be the chairman, Mr. Professor Verzani?
I'm sorry. No, I don't. He did put his hand up first. I was just trying to be polite. My question is about the number of 225,000. Is that a price per student? Are you contracting out with an external firm, or is this to pay for internal costs? It's a little unclear to me what's being proposed here, except a model for bar school preparation and a cost, but I don't know the mechanics of how that'll be spent.
Yes, I'll answer the question. It is for 170 spaces in the bar prep course. We have 155 graduating students, and we have about 15 necessary retakers who did not pass the bar exam the last time. The overall cost normally is around $2,900 per person to take the big three of the bar prep courses. The number that we are suggesting right now that we've been in prior negotiations with brings the number down to about $1,200 per student.
Thank you.
And as to the professor's additional questions?
Please restate. I'm sorry. I missed them.
No, that answered what I had. Thank you, though.
Okay, good. Mr. Hannon.
I had the same concerns as Professor Verzani, so I'll withdraw my hand.
Okay. Are there any other questions or concerns? Hearing none, I think I've moved the item and I have a second, do I not? Is there any further discussion? If not, we'll now vote. So please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. The item 2A1 is unanimously approved. Thank you. Item 2B1 is a resolution to authorize a contract with Outfront Media Incorporated for digital and print advertising as a result of previous declining enrollment rates for the COVID due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And to increase awareness and enrollment, the university is seeking to procure a contract with Outfront Media to place digital and print advertising with the MTA on subway cars, platforms, and entrances. Placing advertisements with the MTA system, with its large presence across the city metropolitan area and 5 million daily riders, will allow the university to effectively achieve the campaign strategic goals. Outfront Media is the exclusive entity responsible for handling advertising placements on behalf of the MTA, and the university is seeking a 5-year contract with Outfront with a total expenditure not to exceed $10 million. Vice Chancellor for Communications and Marketing, Maite Junco, and Associate Vice Chancellor of Communications and Marketing, Monica Tavares, are available to provide further background on this item if required. In the meantime, I'll move the item. May I have a second?
Berger, second.
Is there any discussion on the item? I'm now searching the screen for hands up.
You have one, Professor Verzani.
Professor Verzani.
Quick question, born out of ignorance. Previously, there have been such campaigns. Can we speak to the effectiveness in relation to the current expense that's being requested?
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. The good thing about the multi-year contract is that this will provide better prices, not only for Central, but also for our colleges. Also, by locking prices and services, we won't face fluctuations over the duration of the contract. And of course, it also saves the university and the colleges time, so they don't have to go through the process of securing a state exemption if the expense is over $50,000. I think for other questions, Martin Surla, I think, can answer if you have questions on the procurement end. I don't know.
Mr. Hannon?
I wanted to ask about the fact that it says not to exceed in most cases of this. So when it's saying anything about it, my question has to be here, are we locked into having to keep advertising if the campaign seems to not be taking off, or can we back out of the campaign at any time with however much we've put in, given that the verbiage is that it says not to exceed?
Yes, actually, thank you for the question. 10 million actually is the maximum, and I think it may be more than what we need to, but by having that, we will end up using just based on historical expenses. But I think by making it sort of easier and by having a contract in place, other colleges may want to use this as part of sort of the advertisement sort of menu they have of options. So of course, Subway is one of many options in advertisement. Of course, the majority of our advertising is in the digital space. Hope that answers your question. I think maybe Professor Versani, I didn't fully address your question. I think your hand is raised, so please go ahead.
Professor Versani, you had a question.
Yeah, thank you. I had a question about the revenues generated as well, and I don't know that you're necessarily the right person to answer that, but you may be. Maybe there's someone else who understands what the past advertising scheme brought to the university in terms of revenue benefits.
When you mean revenue, what are you?
So we're asked to approve an authorization of $10 million spent. And the question is, what are we buying for besides ads? Are we expecting to see increased enrollment? Have we had retention success with this? Have we had brand awareness increase? Are there any sort of metrics that could be used to evaluate the cost against the benefits?
I see. We announced both centrally. We have an advertisement budget to, announce, as I said, mostly in digital, but also we are present in TV, in print, in radio, and we have, central in the last couple of years, and mostly ASAP is what has advertised on the Subway platforms. But our schools also, there's nine schools that over the last 5 years, fiscal years, have advertised on the Subway. As I say, I think the Subway, it's an option of the many options we have to advertise to remain competitive, obviously in any market, but also in this sort of post-pandemic market where we have seen a real sharp increase in the expenses of other colleges in the New York City area. We want, to be rank competitive. We want to be, we don't spend at the level that private universities do, but we want to remain competitive and sort of offer the, the CUNY, make sure we're putting our sort of CUNY in front of students, both, DOE grads, but also other students, and happy to, like currently, I don't know if you've ever seen our ads, but currently we have ads for graduate studies up, and we have ads. We're launching actually today or tomorrow our summer campaign in digital. So we're definitely sort of always have a piece of the market, and we want to keep that and expand it for when we need to be in the Subway. Hope that helps.
Professor Versani, I mean, this is a multi approach, right? I mean, we're doing different things. I think Maite is sort of alluding to it, right? It's all part of an overall strategy to digital media and all these different campaigns to try to obviously continue to get the brand out there and continue to remain top of mind as the students are making decisions going forward. So it's a multi-process approach to try to continue to make sure that the brand of CUNY is out there in the community.
And it might be useful to point out that in the wake of enrollment declines, we're going to have to get back in the marketplace and establish our presence and what we're offering. And that would serve everyone's interest. Trustee Berger?
You're muted.
You're muted, Henry.
I'm not sure I've actually heard an answer to the question. I mean, do we have metrics that measure whether these programs are successful? Have we measured the success of past programs? How do we determine whether the program is in any way effective?
So in the digital space, we can track fairly very detailed, you know, the amount of students who click in the ad, go to the page, even to the way they start. They start their application. In, you know, other campaigns, the same with TV, subways, other things, you know, you can track how it's, you know, how it's part of a broader set of messaging. It's harder sometimes on the subway to pinpoint, you know, how many people saw the subway ad and then sort of ended up starting an application. But the subway is normally seen, and particularly I see it as something that complements a broader campaign, not as sort of the main campaign for recruitment of seniors, for seniors or graduate students, or it's mostly really digital. That's where most of the bulk of our, just for you to have a sense, we spent our office is projected to spend $1 million in digital ads this fiscal year. And so the subway normally complements a campaign that perhaps a student sees an ad on the, you know, sees it on Snapchat or sees it in Instagram and then gets on the subway and sees an ad and then maybe gets to his computer and sees it again. And so it's an effort to put the ad in front of a prospective student more than once. The ads on the subway, I agree, have been historically sort of harder to sort of track in terms of how many people see them, and that moves to an action that's across the board. I do want to say that it's not only a multi-year that, like CEO Batista says, but also this contract will be available for all the schools, for the 25 colleges and for Central, or from some programs within Central. So this might not mean just a contract for the Central office or for the communications office.
Well, I will add to that. For example, ASAP has been able to survey the students who apply to the ASAP program. So when we look at their data going back to 2017, 37% of the students who apply to ASAP said that they saw the ad on the subway, right? So they are able to track based on a yearly survey that they do to those students. With our ads, and our intention moving forward with Outfront is to do a short URL, right, that can track that campaign, as well as to start implementing the QR code, right? And we see it, right? A lot of advertisements are doing this, right? You go to the subway, you take your phone, and that will be we will be able to track, right, who saw the ad on the subway by using the short URL and the QR code on our ads.
And one thing else to add to this, Trustee Berger, is the fact that digital media attracts the younger the students, and then the ads in the subway really parents, right? Parents ride the subway. So you're trying different approaches to try to get the word out on CUNY. So I think that that's also part of the strategy.
We have two additional hands up, Mr. Hannon and then Professor Bazzani.
So my question is a comment about who we're targeting on the subway. We say that we're targeting parents more so than younger students themselves on the subway. But one thing we have to take into account is thinking into account the demographic of who are actually the parents of who are starting to go to college now. And if we think about who it is, mainly still millennials who are acquainted with technology and aren't as inclined to start looking at the subway, because this is a generation that grew up with television and understands how these things are moving forward and are now having children going into college. So if we're bringing this input into the subways, I feel that we're doing it just a little bit too late when nobody pays attention to subway ads anymore.
Thank you. The CUNY has had a presence in the subway, I would say, for a long time over the years for different campaigns. And I, you know, just last week, a couple of weeks ago, I saw the ASAP campaign on the subway. And as Monica mentioned, that has been, you know, a campaign that has yielded has gotten a lot of positive results by the subway. I agree with you that it's a mix, that that what we want to offer in our advertisement, it's not just a subway, it's a mix. And you know, we use it sometimes very particularly to complement other campaigns on digital, on TV, on radio, on print, but not on its own. Because you know, I agree with you that our young population and our future students are mostly in digital, but they are also taking the subway. And so the idea is that they are exposed to the same message, if not the same ad, of the value of CUNY, and that they, you know, should consider CUNY as a place to go in different places. And the subway is just one of those places.
And what I will add to that is that, you know, when you think about subway, right, there's print, but there's also digital, right? And you're seeing a lot more digital boards inside carts and also on platforms and as you make your way down the stairs. So we know that, you know, visually a print ad may not attract, right, the viewer versus the digital one, right? So we are really trying to invest more on the digital end than the print, right? Because it does capture your attention much more, especially those with movement.
I see one.
Professor Brazzani, did you have, and then Trustee Sancho.
Just a quick comment. Unlike the student, I do like the ads on the subway, but my question is about how do you decide the balance as to where you're going to put the advertisement? And that's why I was asking for metrics, because from my notes, I wrote down you spent about $1 million a year in digital ads, but $2 million in subway ads. And so earlier you had said you're spending more on digital ads, and it seems like you're spending half as much. I'm not going to judge what's the right amount to spend. I just want to know what the process for evaluation is so that we don't have to make blanket statements about what students want. It's about what students do and who comes to CUNY. I like hearing that at ASAP program, 37% had seen those ads. I'm curious if there's other metrics that are actually employed that allow you to determine what's the proper ratio to allocate these limited funds.
And I'll start, and ABC Tavares can continue. But for Central, we have not been on the subway for the last 2-3 years, actually, as we have favored the digital. But we thought it was important to, as we come back from the pandemic, as we look to expand the footprint on CUNY on the advertisement space, to have this contract in place to give us that variety for that menu. So if anything, we've been sort of constrained on the subway, but I think there are possibilities on the subway. The ridership in the subway is of our students. You know, we're a commuter school and we're a commuter city. And I see so the subway offers a possibility, as I said, to complement what we're offering.
And to that, you're correct. We haven't really done a campaign in the subway system since FY19. But what we do see is that some of our colleges are advertising in subway on a yearly basis. So this is not just about CUNY Central, but about, you know, giving our colleges an opportunity to have reduced rates and to make their process a little bit easier than going to the state for a state exemption every single year if they are spending over 50, right? So we're just looking at this holistically, not only about us, and as you mentioned, right, Jonathan, you as well, we're not saying that we're going to do this every year, but we do have a system in place to make the process easier for us to move forward.
Next is Trustee Sancho.
You know, it's obviously in my day job, I deal with this a lot, and the ever-changing nature of the world of advertising is under siege in the digital era. Traditional advertising obviously doesn't work like it used to, but there's no right or wrong either. You know, we're not selling soap. We're not selling a specific product. And the metrics are complicated in something like this. We do know we have an enrollment issue, and, you know, particularly at the community colleges. And I think part of what is being proposed is seeking to address it. I guess my gut tells me that we're probably, I would not abandon subway advertising. I think it's used widely, you know, New York more than almost any other city. People take mass transit and there are a captive audience, but it's also hard to determine how effective it is. I mean, I like hearing that there is a real move on digital, because clearly that's geared. It's not even only the younger population anymore. It's most people, but certainly a younger population is virtually all digital. But they also do take subway and buses in New York. So I would, I like what I'm hearing, because there's no right or wrong answer in today's crazy world of media and advertising.
Thank you. Mr. Hannon?
Yes, I wanted to ask a follow-up question relating to the fact that we're seeing that a lot of things are moving towards digital. So in the transition that there's the new CUNY online platform, how will that be incorporated into the subway advertising when it starts moving along? Will we start advertising CUNY online through this platform as well?
Yes, we haven't made the decision of what we're going to advertise on the subway or not on once, you know, if everything, if this is in place and all of that. So I don't want to get ahead of it. And, you know, there's a lot of process and a lot of decisions getting there. But I do want to say that we have our CUNY online campaign. It's launched on digital on March 29 and has been running. I hope you have seen it. It's, you know, one of the taglines is, you know, you're busy, we're flexible. And so we're already sort of, out there promoting this the new online offerings.
Okay. We have an item that is moved and seconded. If there is no further discussion, are we ready for a vote? And please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. This item passes unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 2B2 is a resolution to extend the existing contract with Applied DNA Clinical Labs, LLC, for the provision of campus-wide COVID-19 surveillance testing. The university is currently in a one-year contract with Applied DNA Clinical Labs, LLC, for surveillance testing services as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. Due to possible surges in cases due to the Omicron variants or other highly transmissible COVID-19 variants, and as a result of growing in-person presence of faculty, students, and staff, the university has a demonstrated need for continued COVID-19 mitigation measures and is requesting to extend the contract for an additional 12 months commencing with the expiration of the existing contract at a cost not to exceed the original $35 million. I'd like to call on Executive Vice Chancellor and COO Hector Batista to provide a further background on this item if necessary.
So thank you, Chairman. Let me just briefly, just as the chairman stated, we brought to the board in July of 2021 this contract for $35 million. It expires in July of 2022. To date, of the $35 million contract that the board approved, we have spent $7,412,304. We are asking for an extension of this contract to allow us to continue to, as the chairman stated, to continue to make sure that we have a testing protocol for our campuses as we navigate the challenges of COVID-19. Just a couple of highlights. Right now, the scope of the work has really been focused on providing surveillance testing on a weekly basis for the unvaccinated and random tests for those that are vaccinated. And that is based on a 20% of the population. It also really allows us as a university to be able to have a mechanism to allow not only our students, faculty, and staff to be able to, but allow visitors to be able to access our many campuses. We have 19 testing sites, and through this whole process, we remain very nimble to make sure that we continue to address the many challenges that the university sort of faces when it comes to this particular contract. For example, we've had campuses that have asked for different hours because we have staff that are working all different types of hours. So to be able to accommodate that, we have made various adjustments to the 19 sites that we're running. So with that, I will happy to answer any questions, but I turn it right back to you, Trustee Perez.
Before any further discussion on the item, I'll move it. May I have a second?
Berger, second.
Thank you. Is there any further discussion on this item or any questions? Hearing none, we'll now vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. The item passes unanimously. Thank you. Item 2B3 is a resolution to approve a policy on academic excellence fees. The academic excellence fees are used to financially support the unique needs of specific college graduate programs and degrees by increasing the quality of programs offered, adding value to student experiences. The university currently has written practices and requirements on the academic excellence fees, and to continue to ensure that the fees are being spent and revenues are being used appropriately, the university is requesting to formalize these practices and requirements into a policy. Interim CFO Christina Chiappa is available to provide further background on this item if required. In the meantime, I'll move the item. May I have a second?
Berger, second.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions? Is there any discussion on the item? Trustee Berger, Professor Benton, Mr. Hand.
Okay. I noticed that one of the items of permitted uses is to provide tuition assistance to individual students. I always saw these fees as providing services to the entire program. What's the reason for using these fees for individuals?
The logic behind that is we were concerned with some students who may not be able to afford paying the fees. So the colleges sometimes set aside funds to assist those students who don't have the financial means to pay them.
But the provision is for tuition assistance, not to cover these fees, but for tuition assistance. And I'm not sure that that's an appropriate use for these special fees. If I'm alone on that, I'm alone on that, but that's my feeling on this.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone from the chancellery have additional information to shed on this?
So again, we can check on the fees that have been approved, right? Because remember, in all those applications, there's been an explanation as to how the fees are going to be used to see if that pattern, if there's a pattern sort of how frequent that they have been used for that. It's not my sense that that is the case. So there's two additional thoughts connected to that. One is that, so we can do an inventory of that. I think here we're just providing flexibility in case that, again, the departments in sort of submitting the proposals feel that that is something that should be complemented and added to the mix of the things that they were doing. Remember that when these proposals come to us, they've been vetted by faculty and students in those programs, right? So it's been consultation as to the usage. And I guess that can be something that can be examined on a case-by-case basis as they come up for the board for review.
I'm sorry, Chancellor. I don't think I understand that particular policy direction.
I could offer.
Professor Benton, hold on. I missed.
Okay.
What I'm saying is those are potential uses for the fee, right? That's the concern, right? That is a possibility. So, I don't think that they've been used for that fashion in many of the cases that have come up before us, right? And if they're going to be, if they, in a proposal coming forward, right, they appeared, A, the committee would be able to determine whether they think that it is appropriate or not in the usage, and they will come to us based on conversations on the campus from the department, the faculty, and the students that that kind of support is something that they consider necessary or good for the program. So what I'm saying is that there are a couple of layers of, accountability and discussion before that sub potential part of the guidelines could be ever be used.
So for the sake of clarity, what we're talking about is if there is an intent or a proposed specific proposal or suggestion to use some of this or some part of this for tuition assistance in the program, that will come back to the board?
It comes to the board because you will see the proposal. It would lay out what the uses are. So the board will vote on it. And if in the conversation, there's a sense that that is not appropriate or correct, it can be eliminated from that proposal.
Okay. Professor Benton. Trustee Berger, does that respond to your question?
It responds, but it doesn't satisfy me. No, I believe excellence fees have to be carefully used, carefully conceived. The concept is that they're used because there are special needs of the entire program. These fees should not be used to benefit an individual student. If there's need for tuition assistance for an individual student, it should come from other sources, not excellence fees that are being charged to all the students within a program. And as long as that language is in the proposal, I'm going to vote no. I just don't believe that is under any circumstances that's an appropriate use for excellence fees.
I want to return to that thought, Trustee Berger, but let's hear from Professor Bazzani and Mr. Hannon first. Professor Bazzani, you're muted.
No, you had called on Professor Benton. I don't know if you wanted to call on me.
I'm sorry.
I don't want to be the chair. I just want to know.
You're right next to each other. Professor Benton.
Thank you. I had lowered my hand when I had been called on and then was uncalled on. I want to say, as someone who's administered a similar kind of program, the differential tuition, there are students who the result of adding the fee makes the program almost, it's a tipping point of affordability. And if we can target students who are particularly adversely affected by the additional cost and mitigate that cost for them, it is a beneficial result. Furthermore, in our own surveys of the students are very interested in expenditures, investments of the funds that lower their costs of participation. Now, they don't have to be direct payments, but for example, buying textbooks and then loaning the textbooks to the students, it has a tremendous return on investment for students in terms of lowering their costs. And that's a dimension of when we have the students answer how they would like to see the funds invested to help them, that's a dimension of what we hear. I also want to say that I fully support these guidelines and the reservations that I had before are very much resolved by Section 8, in that the audit provision has been fine-tuned to make sure that the scope of the audit is exactly asking what Trustee Berger was mentioning about the purposes and the chancellor, what the purposes of the funds are to be. And so we're not just auditing whether it's an okay expenditure of tax levy funds, but we're auditing whether it's consistent with the board authorized purchases for that specific fund. We also have a provision on assessing the benefit of the fees. And all of the programs, each for accreditation, have to do assessment. And what we want you to be able to see is whether the assessment is demonstrating that the investments of the fees are improving student outcomes and student success. And so you will be able to see that, and you will be able to see the other expectation of assessment, which is that the budget is annually fine-tuned based on assessment to increase the bang for the buck. And so I think this greatly improves this, and I am an enthusiastic supporter.
Well, that's certainly the hope and expectation. We'll see how that pans out. In a while, I want to return to Trustee Berger's suggestion, but we'll hear from Mr. Hannon and then Professor Bazzani. Mr. Hannon.
So what I wanted to say about these fees is we have to take first into account that they're only going to be for graduate programs because that's how academic excellence fees are defined. But another problem that we have there is a lot of students are coming internationally and won't be able to draw the benefits of in-state tuition. So that's a lot of things that we have to think about with CUNY. Where are students coming from and how can these properly be applied to benefit our students? So there are a lot of things to take into account given CUNY has such a diverse student population that we have to take into account every student's situation when we take these policy changes in. Beforehand, there was no accountability with these fees. Let's put some accountability there.
Well, I want to correct your impression. There was accountability, maybe not enough, but I think we tried to improve that the governance of this. Professor Bazzani.
I'd like to commend the interim CFO for working with Professor Benton and myself on our issue regarding assessment of the fees. But I also think that perhaps we could do the same thing for Trustee Berger's issue with the sort of expensive fees on one particular aspect, which, as far as I heard from the chancellor, isn't actually currently in place. And so it could easily be modified. I don't know if Trustee Berger would be comfortable with using the fees as an aggregate to pay for individual fees, but it seems like the reservation for paying for tuition is reasonable. There should be other means that are not tied directly to excellent fees for covering tuition costs for those in need. The fee cost, I don't know, but it seems like if it's not being used, we could excise it from this particular policy, especially with the proposal that everything comes forward back to the board for approval. And if there's one trustee that's not in approval, it's going to cause this conversation to occur every single time there's a new excellent fee proposed.
Is there anyone else? Then Trustee Berger, I have a suggestion. Noting your strong feeling about this, and I have a similar sense about it, would you want to make a motion to excise that particular part of it from the resolution?
Yes, I would. And I would not all, I would also not, look, I think this is a great improvement. It's the one sentence that bothers me. I understand that there may be a need to waive or somehow reimburse the payment of these fees for individual students. I don't have any objection to that. It's the use of the fees for tuition. And I would therefore move that sentence be deleted. And if they want to come back with further amendments later, they may do so.
Is there a second to that motion?
Bazzani, second.
Does everybody understand the motion? We're excising that particular part of it so that no part of these academic excellence fees are used to, yes, Derek, I see that. Are used to defray costs for anyone else. Our counsel, Derek Davis, has a comment.
So it's a question on a friendly amendment that's been offered by Trustee Berger. Rather than, I understand that the point you're trying to make, would it be better rather than to excise the sentence to restrict the use and add language that would say in all such cases, subject to board approval or advanced board approval? Or are you opposed entirely to the concept which would justify an excise in sentence, if the board deemed it appropriate with respect to any such program and the board votes for it, taking it out would eliminate that opportunity for the board to review it.
Let me take a whack at this. I think I understood Trustee Berger's concern about this that would not be answered by anything other than taking out the offending part. And I hesitate to use the term offending, but you know what I mean. And I understand what he is trying to do. We start building layers on top of this thing. It gets even more confusing than it should be. And when we started this, I want to remind everyone who was involved from the earliest days, academic excellence fees were limited. They were always meant to be limited. They were always meant to apply to specifics and programs. They were always meant to apply to students participating in those programs. And when there are variations of the theme, that's a problem. And we were trying to avoid a problem. Is there a second to Trustee Berger's motion?
I second.
Yeah, Professor Bazzani seconded. Are we ready for a vote on that?
Not on the original item
on this motion.
Yeah, can I ask a question, Chairman Frere?
Of course.
Really to Trustee Berger. I get what your objection is. And we all know the history of this. What I'm missing is, so what are we proposing? What are we, besides, you know, if we vote for your amendment, what happens?
My objection is to 100 students in a program putting in money because the program has specific needs and then using that to advantage one student. The only thing my motion would do is say, one of the things you can't use these fees are is for tuition assistance to a particular student. It can be used for any of the broad needs of the program. You need special materials, you need special instruction, you need special whatever, that's fine. But not to advantage, all of the students shouldn't be paying the tuition for one of the students.
And that was the rationale is right from the beginning. Anyone else? Let's have a vote on this motion. All in favor? Opposed? The ayes appear to have it. Now on the original item, and that is 2B3, approving a policy on academic excellence fees as amended. I'll move the item. May I have a second?
Second.
The item as amended is moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on the item?
Do we have to propose any grammatical fixes here from the floor if it wants to be moved forward from committee?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that clearly.
If there are grammatical fixes, do we have to move them here from committee or do they get proposed from the floor of the Board of the Trustees?
What are the specific grammatical changes you propose to make?
In section 10, it says the University of Office of Budget and Finance.
Derek,
the typical approach, Mr. Handler, would be if there are Scribner's errors that are grammatical, I would appreciate your sending them to the secretary. If they're not material, they need not be approved by this committee.
Got it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Now we're ready for a vote. Please only respond if you'd like to abstain or oppose. Item 2B3, is approved unanimously. Thank you.
As amended.
As amended. And thank you, Trustee Berger. With no more items on the policy calendar, I'll address section three, information items. There's one information item on the agenda. Information item is item 3A, the fiscal matters information report, and our interim CFO, Christina Chiappa, is available to answer any questions on this report if that is necessary. Anyone? If there are none and there are no more items on the agenda, I'll move to adjourn. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor? Opposed? Abstaining? This meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.